Let me move on now to part two of this four parts that we have for you, which is all about redesign. So after we have reimagined the purpose of our organization, how do we redesign with intelligence? And our change agent here is Professor Marcus Dussatoy. He is professor, Marcus.
Hi.
So he's professor of mathematics at the University of Oxford, born in London. Research is focused on exploring the mathematics of symmetry, and I actually watched a YouTube video on that. I have to admit I didn't understand everything of it, but it's quite interesting. He's known for his work popularizing mathematics and named by The Independent as one of the UK's leading scientists. He writes for The Times and The Guardian. His most recent book is called The Creativity Code, Exploring the Current State of Creative AI. He presented several BBC TV programs, so people in the UK might know him from that. And he is an avid player of the Asian game of Go, which is might be more important to understand what he's going to talk about than you might think at this moment. Menno?
Yeah, Marcus, so I would like to have other people to learn you a little bit more by answering some simple questions that I've prepared for you. And my question for you would be, could you answer, please, by only saying yes or no, whether you agree with the statement, yes or no?
No, yes, I mean.
that's fine. There are eight statements. So the first one is machines can be creative.
Yes.
One day, machines will be more creative than men.
No.
We should be afraid of AI creativity.
No.
Human intelligence has reached the limits of what we can know.
No.
Is there a piece of art that truly moves you?
AI art.
Yeah. A very important qualification there. There are many pieces of art that move me, but is there an AI one?
Yes.
Actually, not yet, so no.
Okay, because there are a lot of them in your latest book. The Lovelace test is more interesting than the Turing test.
Yes.
One day, machines will have consciousness.
Yes.
You're sure?
Yes.
Okay. And the last one, AI should be able to hold a patent.
Oh, but wait a moment. Sorry to interrupt you, Menno, but I would like to know first what the audience thinks about this last question, whether or not AI should be able to hold a patent before you answer, Marcus. So another mentee question for the audience. So if you take on your device, very good, and you do the same thing, menti.com, and then type in this code, you would get this question. And very simple, should AI be able to hold a patent? And so we already see the votes coming in.
Coming in, yeah.
And again, a strong consensus among the audience, about 80% of the people, again, astonishing that they are so agreeing with each other. Mm-hmm. We have about 77% of people that say no, AI should not be able to hold a patent. And there are 24% actually that say yes, maybe it should. So, Marcus, what's your answer to this last question?
What's the right answer?
What's the right answer, yes.
Well, I think this is actually a very complicated question to have just a simple yes, no. But I did actually answer yes when I answered the Menti poll. I think that we're going to have to reimagine what we think of as ownership of ideas in this kind of new age. And one of the things will be, how do we credit an AI that may have been the one that's made a creative act in coming up with something?
Yes, because I believe there are examples that actually when they did a research, if they had to point one person that did the invention, it was the AI system.
Well, you see, I think I rather like Brian Eno's idea that we get very obsessed with the idea of genius, and we need to change this to the idea of seniors, that there are many people involved in these kind of innovative acts. And one of them may be the piece of AI, which is somehow, I think, starting to become independent from the human who coded the AI. And that's why I think we're going to really have to wrestle with this, that this is not the human who's made this thing. It really is the AI.
Yeah. I'm not going to ask you where the money goes if the AI owns the patents, but someone will find out where the money will go. Let me ask you about your latest book, The Creativity Code. What was the defining moment that you sort of decided that AI can in fact be creative? Was there a special happening or something that triggered you that made you write about this?
Yes, well, I think that in some sense, many people's reaction to that question about a patent and saying, no, it can't hold a patent, is because we still believe that AI, if it comes up with an idea, that really it's the human who wrote the code that should be credited with the output.
Exactly.
So I think many people still are very suspicious of whether AI could really be creative. And for me, I really saw a phase change in 2016, which kind of jump-started this book, which was this game of Go that you mentioned, that a piece of code challenged the world's expert at this ancient Chinese game of Go. It's played on a 19 by 19 grid. You put black and white stones down and you try and surround more of your opponent's territory than their surrounding of yours. And traditionally, this is a very hard game to write code for because we had to write code in a very sort of top-down manner, write the instructions for what the machine would do. But we're starting to write code in a very different way, which is allowing code to actually be creative, I think, in its own right. Very bottom-up manner. This thing many people have probably heard of called machine learning, deep learning. This is where the code is allowed to play the game and learn by making mistakes. And each time it loses a game, it can understand what were the moves that were might have won it the game. So, okay, we've got quite used to code playing games and beating humans at things. But for me, there was something very special that happened in the second game that AlphaGo played against Lee Sedol, this Korean.
You were watching the game live because you're a Go player yourself, are you?
I was very, you know, I thought this was humanity against the machines. Yeah. And, you know, I was rooting for humanity. So I watched these obsessively on YouTube live. And I remember there was a moment during the second game, quite early on, when AlphaGo, 37th move of the game, suggested putting a black stone on the fifth row in from the edge. Now, when my Go master taught me to play this game, he would have slapped my wrists had I made that move, because it's considered a very weak move to play deep into the center of the board that early on in the game. So I remember all the commentators gasping at what a terrible move the AI had made, that AlphaGo had made. But as the game went on, AlphaGo showed why this move was actually an incredibly valuable move. It turned out to be the move that won AlphaGo that game. So for me, this passed three things I'm looking for if I'm going to call something creative. I'd call something creative if it's new. Well, machines can make new things very easily, but that's not very interesting. It's got to be surprising to us. So it's got to move us emotionally. And that move did surprise us because it was considered such a bad move. But then the third thing is value. Can you get value out of that surprising newness? And AlphaGo showed that move had value. It won it the game. So it's taught us as humans to play this game in a new way, which is so exciting. But for me, the crucial thing is, had a human seen that line of code embedded in the many lines that AlphaGo had of code, they probably would have deleted it, saying that's a bad move.
Yeah.
But AlphaGo, this piece of AI, showed us humans how to do things in a new way. And for me, that's what's exciting. It's redesigning the world around us. It's certainly redesigned how we think about playing this game. It's kind of kicked us off what we thought was the peak of the way to play this game, and revealed that actually we were on a low mountain and there was a huge, great, towering Everest, which AlphaGo has now showed us a new way to play this game at a much higher peak.
So humanity against AI, Michiel, we have lost.
Yeah, well, in certain very specific areas for now. But so in the conversation we had earlier, Marcus, to prepare for this summit, you made a bold claim where you said, well, the internet shaped society, or internet technology shaped society and organizations from, let's say, 1997 to 2015. Dominant players emerged, like first Amazon with the e-commerce powerhouse, then, of course, these two-sided markets and the sharing economy with Airbnb and Uber. Of course, Facebook and the social media emerged, and they become the dominant player in the economy. And now your bold claim is that AI will shape society and the economy from 2016 to 2030. So explain to me where this conviction comes from, and tell me what we may expect.
Yes, well, I think your initial thought is, well, a game, that's a very restricted environment. It doesn't really show us very much. And that was really the journey of my book. I wanted to see, well, where else could it be creative? Because, you know, many businesses, well, the human species, I think, it's something we regard as uniquely ours, our acts of creativity. And for me, when I saw some very exciting uses of this technology to really show us how to do things in a new way. So, for example, I saw a jazz musician and a jazz AI improviser called the Jazz Continuator. The AI learnt on the sound world of the jazz musician and then started playing back in a kind of call and response mode. And the jazz musician listened to what the AI was playing, Bernard Lubat, a Parisian French pianist. And he said, I recognize that world. It's my world, but it's doing things I've never, ever thought of before. And for me, this is what's key, that we humans tend often to behave rather mechanistically. We repeat behaviors that have been successful in the past. We behave like machines. And I'm seeing the AI acting by pushing us out of our comfort zone and showing us how to be creative again as humans. So I like this idea that we're not a competitor in a game, we're actually a collaborator in making something new together. And another example, which I think will be really important tool for many businesses, is a new idea of something called a generative adversarial network. And I've seen this used in the visual realm to produce not things that we recognize, but really new things. I think that's the challenge. Can AI work outside the box? Can it break style? You know, we're used to it making things which we recognize, but can it really take us into the new? And this is two algorithms kind of working almost against each other like a game. So one's the generative algorithm, making new things, trying to break style. And then you've got a discriminator algorithm, which is judging what the AI is making. Has it moved far enough, or perhaps it's moved too far so we don't recognize what it's making as potentially visual art? And the things which would emerge out of this, I think, have been very exciting because it's taking us genuinely into a new style of art.
Yeah, so and then you probably expect that we have seen this AlphaGo moment now for this playing the game of Go. But probably you expect these AlphaGo moments to occur in many other domains as we speak, or going to the foreseeable future, right?
I think that's the challenge. You know, how can you use this new tool to help you have that AlphaGo moment in the domain that you work in? So I've seen, you know, a couple of really significant AlphaGo moments in the art world, the science world, actually very exciting. For example, new drugs emerging where the AI is allowed to learn on the drugs that we've made. You know, one of the real big issues is pathogens that are resistant to antibiotics. And AI has started to look at the antibiotics we've made, see something which is kind of common to all of them, but then to break it and make something new, suggest a new molecule that isn't one we've seen before, but has characteristics of the ones that have been successful. And it's come up with ideas for molecules which actually do attack these pathogens which are resistant to the antibiotics we have at the moment. So I think the exciting thing is, this is like Galileo being given a telescope and being able to see deeper into the world of data than we ever have before. And it's, you know, what can you do with this new tool to help you sort of change, redesign the way that you do things?
Yeah, now, so it's quite interesting. And so, because of course, in this internet era, we saw that organizations needed to adjust to make best use of this new technology emerging. And of course, we called that digital transformation, right? Now, if we look at it in a rather abstract way, organizations are man's attempt to effectively collaborate on a common goal. In this new age of AI, the challenge, of course, is not only to let human collaborate effectively with each other, but to have them collaborate with intelligent, creative machines. So what do you think? How do organizations need to redesign or need to change to be successful in this new age?
Oh, well, that's interesting. I think Navi had four different suggestions. So perhaps I can choose four things in my kind of attempt to redesign organizations. So I think actually you've mentioned one of them already, which is collaboration, and to recognize that this is a very powerful collaborator. I think it was quite a challenge when you said, could machines be more creative than humans? I think that's a very hard question to answer because we think in very different ways. So that's a very sort of linear way of thinking of things. And I think the exciting thing is we're creating something which is different from our intelligence. I actually prefer to call AI augmented intelligence, not artificial intelligence. And we're really making something which is perpendicular to the way we think. And that's why together we can play the game of Go, analyze a radiology scan, and be much more successful than each one individually. So collaboration is key. I would say data is absolutely essential here. I mean, we've heard many times the idea of data being the new oil. I think a lot of people are sitting on data that they are finding difficult to analyze themselves as humans. And as I said, Galileo had a telescope, saw further. This is your telescope to see much deeper into the data and to spot patterns that that perhaps we've missed before in that data. Take Netflix. They actually managed to define a new genres of film based on the likes and dislikes of the users. And we didn't even have names for these genres, but the AI recognized sort of groupings of films that deserve to be collected together. The other one I would say is this thing is a bit like a black box, and there are dangers with that because the learning process is producing extremely complex layers of code, and we need to be careful that we're not putting bias into these algorithms that then are disrupting the direction we're going in. So I really think digital literacy is going to be essential in ensuring that we remain in control. And perhaps that's my fourth one, that I think we need to put the human back in. I think your CXO mentioned the idea of the employee, your CXO panel. I think that we need to make sure that the AI is empathetic, that it is on our side, and that we remember that the human is central in this, and that the AI doesn't somehow go off on its own journey, leaving us in its wake.
All right. Thank you very much, Old Menno.
Well, I have a last question, but I get another question from one of the teams here I would like to ask you. In a highly polarized world, could AI be the objective mediator of conflicts, ideas, and judgments?
Well, it's very interesting because there's been a lot of exploration about morals and AI. Mm-hmm. And I've done a few events with Ian McEwan, actually, the novelist, who one of his recent books is all about the role of that AI will play in society. And the interesting fact that AI, faced with a moral challenge, will probably produce a very moral solution in contrast to what we humans do. So sometimes it's maybe important to allow the AI not to learn on the way humans think, to be able to think more cleanly. But I think there are interesting challenges ahead. For example, driverless cars are going to have AI inside the car. You're going to have the philosophy 101 challenge. Do you kill five people on the road or the driver? Now, the driver's bought the AI in the car. So, you know, do you sacrifice the driver, one life, as opposed to the five that if you make another decision? So I think that that's why it's very important that we have this debate about the role that AI will be playing in society, because it's going to have a massive impact. And we need to make sure that people are aware of the role that it's going to play in the decision-making processes ahead.
So I guess that's a no.
So very quickly, last question for you, Marcus. So you talk about the challenge for organizations to create an organization that learns as fast as machines do, right? So what's at the core of such an organization? What's really the crucial thing that those organizations have to do?
Well, I think it's interesting to see why is this AI suddenly able to learn so well? And partly it's because it's learning from failure. It only learns and changes. The code updates every time it gets something wrong. And then it assesses, what was it that I did wrong last time? And if I did something different, I would do it right the next time. And so it's taking a lot of risks, actually, in exploring its environment and the data and learning from the mistakes that it's making. And I think that that's a very interesting model. You know, I'm involved at university and education, and I think often we're very conservative. We expect everyone to get maths answers right the first time. So I think the one learns very fast, and as fast as the machine. I'm not sure we'll ever be as fast as learning as the machine, but actually an organization which allows the exploration of failure and learning from failure. So
all right.
That idea of agility was mentioned before. I think that's really important here, being able to adapt and change very quickly, which is what the AI is doing.
Yeah, and apply the insights that the AI, the new insights and the new ideas that AI is coming up with. So, we are already out of time, Marcus. As it always goes when we have a conversation, time goes fast. I would like to go, and we will hear from you a little bit later on, after this roundtable discussion. So the second discussion we want to have about this topic of redesigning for AI. All industries, as Marcus has explained, will probably see their own AlphaGo moment. And so change is required in business models, product services, maybe organizational design. And so what I would like to have the groups do is go to your group, or you're already in your group, but discuss how will you use AI to beat your competition. And hopefully we can create again some consensus in your group and to come up with the best three ideas of your group, which we then will discuss. Again, 15 minutes for the discussion, and then a nano break for a quick cup of coffee of like 5 minutes. So we will see you back here in exactly 20 minutes from now. I find it very interesting, Menno, for this group in Sweden. So that basically what they're saying is that there has to be a right balance between the huge opportunity that AI can offer and the risks that an organization can run when they get it wrong, right? The reputational risk is tremendous. And so in the words that that Marcus already explained, I think, yes, you should experiment, but don't experiment by burning down the house, right? So you have to have boundaries of what you are able to experiment about. I'm really interested in what the CXO panel took out of this last part about redesign. And so let's go back to Joseph, formerly known as Pierre, and hear what the four J's now, Jordan, Jurgen and Johan, what they have to say. And so there they are. So, Joseph?
Yes.
Yes, I can hear you. Hi, Pierre, or Joseph, sorry. So what were the conclusions from your discussion, how to translate these thoughts into action?
Well, first of all, you will not be surprised to hear that we are taking just positions, okay? So that will be the fifth J. But we have three very different angles on the topic. I think three very interesting angles. And I'd like to start with Jorgen. Jorgen is the chief product officer of HERE, the company which produces navigation systems. And they do use machine learning on a very large scale and have learned quite a few lessons, didn't you, Jorgen?
Yeah, we do. And in addition to navigation systems, we produce also maps that are used for autonomous driving or, let's say, assisted driving, which are features that don't necessarily take responsibility, which is one of my points. But I think, so we use machine learning extensively in order to produce maps from huge amounts of data, sensor data collected from cars, imagery, LiDAR data collected from our own kind of vehicles, as well as all sorts of satellite and aerial imagery. Just because we cannot produce the maps manually, there's too much world that changes too often at that level of resolution to do it with people. But we would not be able to scale that. So we use machine learning, and we learned that that's not easy, and in a number of ways. But I think the two most important lessons are that it's actually very difficult to approach the level of quality and accuracy that humans have. I think we drive 7 million kilometers on average without having an accident. It's actually really difficult to create an automated system that approaches that level of safety. And it's very difficult to create really, really high-quality map data that obviously has to reflect reality. And it's kind of asymptotic. Every next percent of quality is twice as hard or three times as hard as the previous percent. And so we don't really know whether we can get to 100% ever. And the second thing is it's quite hard to scale. And there's obviously technology for that. But we do this on a global level with every road in the world in principle. And just the amount of data that comes in and the amount of machine learning we have to do is tremendous. The second question I think it throws up, which is less, I think, specific to us, but more to the autonomous driving use case, is who's actually responsible with level three cars that are the first one of which has been announced and will be on the market mid next year, the car actually takes responsibility. So the driver can disengage, watch Netflix. But if there's an accident, then who's really responsible? And regulators and manufacturers are struggling with that question.
Thank you, Jorgen. And now here is using AI for competitive advantage. Johan, if you could talk about your experimentations.
Yeah, well, what I see in general, if you think about machines, of course, compared to human beings have like chemical things in their brain. It's not necessarily very rational what we do. And with machines, we have this massive speed and this massive memory of facts. Now, what we can do with artificial intelligence, of course, is that we can use that power to do a lot more. And if you think about the examples, I think that we can do discovery, we can do pattern recognition, but I think one of the most important things is massive experimentation. And because if a human does an experimentation, and we do it in the bank, we have a special methodology for that. You can do 3 experiments in the afternoon, and maybe you're already experimenting something that was done before. And you're not randomizing enough. Now, with randomization algorithms, probably you invented that the black button on the fifth row was a good idea. And you wouldn't do that without randomization. Right? So that power, I think, for experimentation is tremendous because you can use that speed and that algorithms to just go ways you never imagined.
That's competitive advantage if there is one. Have a very different.
Pierre, you broke up, so.
Ah, sorry. I was just passing the baton to Jordan to understand your angle on the question.
I think my angle was a little bit different than the others, and it was really most around trust and change management with AI, both within an organization and then with your customers. So how we partner and how we collaborate with AI at a place such as the American Dental Association, where you have scientists who are used to working in a particular way, users who are used to working in a particular way, and even members or customers who are used to receiving information. How do you build that trust in AI, and how do you change an organization? What's the change management process around AI for adoption to be successful? Because it's obviously a big investment, but that change management piece has to be critical, has to be looked at very, very thoroughly.
Thank you, Jordan. If Michiel, if you allow me two thoughts in conclusion of this contribution of the panel. First of all, we were unanimous. We are unanimous in thinking that for any company to decide to pull the plug on AI would be a very courageous and probably competitive power destroying decision. That's one point. The other one is that I've been working for 3 years to improve the collaboration within Capgemini, is a relatively large company. And I find the collaboration between humans quite complicated. And I'm not sure I look forward to including a few hundreds of AI collaborators into this collaborative exercise. However, when someone explains to me what it is, I'll be keen to experiment.
Very good, Pierre. So thanks very much for these solid thoughts and putting some strategic actions again on the agenda. I would like Marcus to respond really quickly to what you're hearing. And Marcus, I already have a very specific question for you. So we discussed at the beginning about AI, whether or not it should hold a patent. But then in the case of AI driving a car, could I actually litigate against an AI algorithm when it does something wrong?
I think this is a really important issue about where the ownership of the thing is. And we have to understand that an AI is learning on data. So who created the data is going to be part of that responsibility. Who curated the data that gets fed to the algorithm? So there are so many issues that we need to discuss as a society. So many interesting points there. But I'd just like to pick up on one, which is the possibility to create bespoke experiences for customers, for users. I think this is a really exciting opportunity and one that we can do almost over the next probably 5 years. You know, I'm an author of a book. I have to write one book which works on multiple minds. I would love to be able to work with an AI that learns what you know. Perhaps you know some mathematics. Perhaps you know no mathematics. Perhaps you know what an algorithm is, and produces a bespoke version of my book based on what you've read already. And I think that that's not an unrealistic possibility in the years to come.
So everybody will have its own personal book about your next upcoming book. Maybe that will be about that. So thank you very much, Marcus, for being with us today and your contribution. And, well, of course, we will talk again soon. Thanks a lot, Marcus.